Together this morning to confess with our mouths and our hearts that you, King Jesus, are Lord. Lord, we know that this is true. And it is from that truth that we sing. Some of us, these words are true, that I have nothing else to give except for a hallelujah to you. Some of us feel like we've been on a good path, and yet we come back to the fact that all we have to give ourselves is a hallelujah back to you. It doesn't matter where we've come from, Lord. We've come into this space to worship you, King Jesus, and make much of you. Not make much of what you've done in us and through us and for us, but to make much of you, Jesus. All of those things are a shadow of who you are. You are King, you are Lord, you are Savior. And so any blessing that you have poured out on any one of us should always point us back to you. And so, Lord, we're bringing you that hallelujah together as a church to confess that you are Lord and you are Savior of all. In the midst of various trials and afflictions, we count it all joy, knowing that those trials and afflictions, they produce an endurance, they produce character, which produces hope, and we're just thankful that the hope that we have is not in ourselves and our effort, but our hope is in you, King Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this time of worship, to be able to make much of you and center our hearts. It's in your beautiful name. Amen. Would you be seated? Well, here we are. Glad to be back in the saddle, if you will. Glad to be back preaching, and glad to be back with our church family. As many of you know, we were on, I guess you could call it vacation. I don't call it vacation because we weren't all together. My little kids were at my parents' house while the big kids and Jay and I were in Florida for Leilana had an All-American thing there, and she did very, very well, and so we're very proud of her. We clearly were, because we went to Florida in the summertime, right? Like, I mean, who would do that, like, willingly? No, I'm just kidding. But it is good to be back. I would also say, I don't, some of you may know, but my mom started cancer treatments this week. She has stage 3 endometrial cancer, I think is what it's called, and she has started her first round of chemo this week, and so would you keep her in your prayers, please? And so we actually got together last week to just kind of honor her, if you will, all except my youngest sister had COVID. She came back from Germany and got COVID. So she couldn't be there. It hurt her and her husband. But the rest of us were there to do like a photo shoot thing with her. And so that's where we were last week. I'm excited about my mom's attitude through it. And I talked to her Friday, and she was doing okay. Glad to be knowing what the plan is. My mom is a planner, and so she's just glad that she has a plan. We have been gone the last 2 weeks doing a few of those things, and glad to be back here. Thank you to Alan for bringing the word the last 2 weeks. Can we give it up for Alan? You did a wonderful job. I read the notes both weeks and was excited that he was up here delivering the word, because he had some good things to pull out of the text. So if you have a Bible, I would invite you to grab it and open up to 1 John chapter 5. And so I say all the nice things about Alan to then say that we're actually going to We're actually going to be going through 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. And you're like, wait a minute, Alan did 1 through 5 last week. Yes, he did. But I couldn't make the sermon make sense of 6 through 12, so we're going to go 1 through 12. Are you guys okay with that? Little bonus Bible teaching time. Hope you're okay with that. No, he did a great job, but the whole section just makes sense if it's preached together. So, are you ready? Wow, not a lot of you are ready. We ready to get in the Word? Dive in? Yeah. So, I want either a head nod or a wave of some sort if you've heard this before, okay? Like father, like son. Yeah. You're just like your mom. Yes. That's usually a lot of daughters really enjoy hearing that from their husbands about. No, maybe not. But some aren't. Beth, I've always said it in love about Jayla. Okay. I'll give you another question to ponder. You don't have to say it out loud, but which parent do you remind yourself more of? So I personally am like, if you could cut me in half, I'm half my mom, half my dad. Like the personality is a very interesting thing, and the way we are wired, I'm very much, I resemble the two of them. Our kids are some weird connection. All five of them are some weird, like replicas of us somehow, right? It's just interesting how we are like our family, if you will. Our Danini family has some distinct characteristics, and one of those is birthmarks. Birthmarks. Which side? Here it is. It's over here. I've got a birthmark right here. It's right here. Can't see it, but I can. And my dad has the exact same birthmark. And Audrey has the exact same birthmark. Isn't it interesting? It's almost like birthmarks are evidence of where you belong, right? That's really what we're going to dive in today, is that birthmarks are evidences of faith, okay? Not necessarily skin birthmarks, but birthmarks. So this is just some review to get us caught up to where we've been. But we're coming to the close of this letter, 1 John, and we're coming out of the section of love where John wants us to be loving with our actions. And he wants us to know first that we are loved as we abide in Christ by the Holy Spirit. That is our identity, is our abiding in Christ. You are in Christ. That is your identity. You are not firefighter, architect, shipyard worker, Navy guy, retired. You're not all of those things. You are in Christ, and you go do those things. You tracking? Does that make sense? Yeah? All right. We are loved so much that God made the effort to seek you in order to shape and mold you further into his image. We are shaped and molded as we love. And we perfect, we complete God's love when we love others. When we love others, it makes God's love visible to others. You tracking with that? So his love in us, it's in us when we make a heart confession that Jesus is Lord, and then God himself indwells us as believers. And therefore, the love that flows out of us is an intentional, purposeful love. It's not merely a feeling or an emotion. We know when we are loving with a perfect God-like love because his perfect love drives out fear. Okay? So if you are fearful about anything today, it may be that you are doubting God. And I'm not talking about a little bit of nervousness about things, but I'm talking about a fear that stalls any sort of godly progress and any sort of ability to love others. It could be from a place of doubt in our God. So the bottom line is this, is that you say you are a believer and that you love God. If you do that, then you will love people. So as a Christian, we can't sit here and say, I don't like people. Not allowed. We, as brothers and sisters, ought to hold you accountable and say, well, then you don't love your God. If you say, I don't do people, well, God kind of said we had to, right? Because it's out of our love for him that we love others. And so loving others, it is an evidence of faith. You might even say that loving others is a birthmark. We continue this topic of love as evidence of faith. We're going to come back to chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. And then we're gonna walk through this as quickly as we can. So let's go ahead and dive in today after a word of prayer. Lord, be with our minds and our hearts now that they might be aligned with you, that you might be able to teach us through your word. It's in your beautiful name. Amen. Chapter 5, verse 1. You ready? If you don't have a Bible, if you don't know how to look it up on a Bible, there's a thing on the screen for you. I'm also going to read it to you, so there's no way that you shouldn't be able to listen to this. You ready? All right, let's do it. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. This is a repeat of the previous theme that we've been in the last few weeks. I know Alan preached it last week, and so I'm just giving some highlights here. But if you love the Father, you'll love his kids because they're your brothers and sisters, right? You have a different affection for your family than for anyone else. But John is saying you now have another family, a church family. And it's not like a family, but an actual family with a perfectly loving father. Another theme, a second theme, is obedience overflowing from love. So love for God is actually shown by us in our obedience to God. Right? So it's like we're saying, I listen because I love. This sounds a lot like children and parents because it is. Our children's obedience is motivated by love for the parents. They do what we ask because they trust us and they love you and they know that you have their best interest in mind. And when they don't obey, not if, but when, the reminder to our young kids or old kids is not a you better or else type of motivation, because that's fear, and perfect love casts out fear. So the discipline of our kids, it needs to be a reminder of who they are, or who they and how they are or are not loving. It's not a matter of like, do this because I said so. It has to be more of a, hey, does that showing love for me or love for them? No? Okay, let's pivot that to this. Like, the reason I'm asking you to do this is not because I'm this authoritarian person over you, but it's because out of we show our love for God by loving others. And if that's not very loving, then that's the problem. Right? And I know that might sound like all roses and fairy tales, and, you know, maybe for some of you it is, but this takes some trust building, and in some cases is a reimagining of what discipline might look like in your home. It also takes a reminder that this is exactly how God disciplines us. He never does it from a fear motivation. He always disciplines us because of by way of love, right? And so you might be thinking, I don't do this well. I'm telling you that most of the time, I'm terrible at this. And then, typically, God reminds me of his love for me, and I have to quickly go apologize to my kids and remember that if God's extended grace to them and to others, then certainly he's extended it to me, right? There's so much grace-based parenting that needs to be set out in our world today, because there's either no discipline or there's abusive discipline. We need to find the balance of godly discipline, which is motivated by love, not fear. Amen? Let's look at verse 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Here's what he means. We become new creations in Christ. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, we have a new nature. We have a new nature. And with this comes new affections, new passions, new treasures and values, because I now love God instead of hating him. Romans 1 says that. I treasure and value him above all else, and therefore I delight in obeying and pleasing him. Now I see his commands not as a burden, but as a blessing. John Piper says that what you desire to do with your whole heart is not burdensome to do. The changed heart desires to love and obey the Lord. I didn't say you'll do it all the time perfectly. I said you desire to. Right? That is the big difference. Because a lot of people will say, well, they're not saved because they act like heathens. Careful. Because the desire of their heart might be to not be a heathen. But they need God's grace to cover and continue to walk in faithful obedience towards holiness and righteousness. They may not be where you are, but it doesn't mean that they're not in a better place than they were yesterday. So the mark of salvation is a draw to the Lord. Because if you are not, if someone is not saved, the Lord is not ever calling and reaching on them. I promise you. But just careful. Careful with our judgments. So the question for us today is, where's your heart's desire? Because remember that indifference is also a posture. It's not just love and hate towards God, but it's also indifference. So when you hear the command of God to love people, do you get angry or do you respond with joy? I want to look at a couple of Psalms here to help us maybe paint this picture. Psalm 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Look at 40 verse 8. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. 112 verse 1 says, praise the Lord. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. Psalm 119, 174 says, I long for your salvation, O Lord, and your law is my delight. John Stott says, love provides the motive for obeying the commands of the law, but the law provides specific direction for exercising love. So we can't just go love God the way we want. His word tells us how to love him. loving God rightly is more than external behavior. It must be driven by a gospel gratitude of your heart. It's not that I have to, it's that I want to. Let's look at verses 4 and 5. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? So verse 4 literally reads, the one who has been born of God conquers, is continually victorious over the world. Who or what are we victorious over? I want you to remember that the world is characterized by lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life. Remember we talked about that earlier in chapter 2, verse 16. We have victory over these sins because of love, but now John gives a second weapon of victory over these sins, and that weapon is faith. John gives us a balance between new birth or new creation and our faith. And that is, it's God's sovereign work and our human responsibility. So through new birth in Christ, accomplished by faith in the Messiah, the Son of God, and the power of worldly desire is broken, and we gain victory over those things. Danny Aiken says that the world is no longer my passion, God is. Sinful attractions are no longer beautiful to me, God and His will are beautiful. Overcomers, followers of Christ, those who have experienced new birth by faith are no longer consumed by what we don't have, which is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, or what we do have, the pride of life. And we are free from those chains, and God's new birth is offered to us to make it all possible. Faith gives us eyes to see Him. In the language of verse 5, the believe that Jesus is the Son of God, it denotes a continuous action. The one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God, that's a continuous action of belief. It's not a one-time belief, but a lifetime pursuit and belief that Jesus is the only way to salvation. And folks, I'm here to tell you, it is not your heritage. It's not your standing in the community. It's not your political leanings or even your actions that save you. It is only faith in Christ. Let's pick it up in verse 6 to 8. This is He who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood. And these three agree. Faith shows the reality of what is hoped for. It is the evidence of things that we cannot see. Hebrews 11:1 tells us that. So John is pointing to evidence that you can see, just in case you lack in faith. None of us were there with Jesus. I know some of you are older, but none of you are that old. Jesus said to His disciples, blessed are you who see and believe, but more blessed are those who do not see and believe. However, the problem, it's not with the evidence. The problem here is with the unbelieving heart. Because here's the evidence that we see here. The evidence is baptism. John is talking about Jesus' actual baptism, which is mentioned in all four Gospels. Why do you think it was mentioned in all four Gospels? It's because the triune God is revealed in His baptism. You're like, I don't know, Pastor. Well, let's look at Matthew 3. Verses 16 and 17 says, when Jesus was baptized, Jesus, by the way, is the Son. That's one of the three in the Trinity, if you're wondering, if you're scoring at home. There's three in the Trinity. It's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, okay? Just so we're tracking. When Jesus, there's one, was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son. Who says that they're a son? A father would say that. So we see evidence, with whom I'm well pleased, sorry. We see evidence of the Trinity here in this passage. Jesus is baptized to identify himself with us. He's saying, I am the Son of God. The sinless for the sinful, just like the cross where he shed his blood. The sky went black. The curtain was torn. The earth quaked. He bled, he died, and he hung on a cross, substituting himself for propitiation. Jesus didn't belong in either place. He didn't need to be baptized to be holy or to repent. He didn't have to repent. There was nothing. If you are sinless, what is there to repent of? But he did it to identify with us. He also didn't need to go to the cross. He didn't do anything wrong. Right? He didn't belong in either place. Yet he was on a singular mission to reconcile the world to himself. He came to die for us and to change us. By what? By the power of the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is the third witness. And here's what that means. Because the Holy Spirit is truth, he confirms the testimony of Jesus. Think about this. The Holy Spirit was present in the conception of Jesus. The Holy Spirit was present at Jesus' baptism. The Holy Spirit was present at Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. The Holy Spirit was present throughout Jesus' ministry. And he always did his work by the power of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit testifies through the baptism and the crucifixion that Jesus is the Son of God. And it's not on us to prove this evidence. It's on others to disprove it. Because it's been very clearly laid out in the scriptures. He is who he says he is. For people who don't want to believe it, they're not going to believe it. I would argue they can't believe it without God revealing it to them. Through what? Through the Holy Spirit. I know some of you well enough to know that you think that gives you a free ticket to sit and get and never to have to share your faith. And I promise you it's not, because God uses us as vessels to share the good news of Jesus Christ. But he removes from us the burden of their decision. He says, I'll take that on. You go be my hands and feet. And their decision isn't on how good you are. Thank the Lord that people's decision to follow Jesus Christ for eternity is not on me. Because I screw it up over and over and over again, as many of you can attest to. But praise be to God that our obedience to go and share the good news of the gospel of grace, it is out of that sharing that God shows up and rescues those lost folks and brings them into an eternal kingdom. And we have brothers and sisters today sitting in this room that were dead who are now alive because of your obedience. Praise be to God. Let's keep going. Let's do 9 through 12. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that he has borne concerning his Son, that whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. That could not be clearer. Believing in Jesus as the Son of God is equivalent to accepting God the Father's testimony about his Son. Rejecting this is like charging God with perjury. We confess and believe with our whole being, our whole heart, and this is the internal witness of the Holy Spirit at work, confirming the right to believe in Jesus as the Son of God. This testimony is true now. Listen, past experiences can be helpful, but it's an ongoing present day testimony that confirms your relationship with God. What does that mean? It means that your best evidence of faith in Christ shouldn't come from a long time ago. Your fruit of faith should be evident even more today than it was back in the 90s. Does that make sense? So you can't point back to, well, back in 2008, I'll tell you what, we did this, this, and this, and, you know, I was in this Bible study, I did these things, and then in 2010, yeah, I got a little busy. And now 2024, you know, I'm still a believer, but no one would know it. That's not evidence of fruit, that God is rooted and seated in your life, is it? There's a great heart confession that leads to eternal life. And the question for you today is, where's your heart? Nobody said you had to be perfect, but where is your heart today? Because your feelings and your emotions are fleeting. They will trick you. But where are your convictions? I'll quickly share this situation with my mom having cancer, and just some things going on in Jay's and my life. It's not been fun lately in the Denny household, right? And I've not felt the Lord close to me, but I know he's close to me. I'm not going to be led by my emotions. I had to say this to Jayla this week, that I had to read the scripture, or say the scripture over to her, that these afflictions ought to be, because there's not a lot of joy in our life right now. And so, but afflictions ought to bring joy, because they produce character, which produces endurance, which produces hope. So sometimes you have to prophesy to yourself that it's true, even when you don't feel that it's true. Sometimes you have to tell yourself that God is faithful. He is good. His love endures forever. Even when I don't understand. Sometimes we don't feel it, but that doesn't make our faith untrue. This is why we stay faithful in our spiritual disciplines, even when we don't feel like it. We confess Christ as Lord and Savior daily. It is the only way to have life. Why does it matter? Why does any of this matter? It's because faith makes us see that Jesus is better. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. It is the birthmarks of right belief. It's the birthmarks of love. It's the birthmarks of behavior. And my plea this morning is that you would choose life that's found in Jesus Christ alone. My prayer is that you would receive Jesus as Lord and Savior if you have not already, and if you already have, that you would remember that He is. That this would be a time, we could move into this time of response, of remembering that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and that He has done everything that needs to be done in order that He be glorified in your life. There's nothing that you can do to make Him love you more, nothing that you've done to make Him love you less. And it's because He is enough. So would you let Him be enough today? Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we confess today that You are God, You are good, that Your mercies endure forever, that You are our peace, our comfort, our rock, our Redeemer. And Lord, we come to You right now with an attitude and a spirit of confession that these things are true. And Lord, I pray that everyone in this room would respond to Your word being spoken, not with emotions or feelings, but we would respond with conviction that You are who You say You are, and therefore I am who You say I am, a child of You, and I'm going to go live like that right now and beyond today. So Lord, as we take this cup, we take this wafer, and as they represent Your body broken and Your blood shed for us, we take these things knowing that You are enough. I don't need to do anything else for this substitutionary atonement to be ratified. I don't have to do anything else to make this okay. You've already done it. So Lord, let me know that and believe that and receive that today as we take these elements, as we give back to You what You've already given to us, as we respond in worship. I pray that we would do so with a new conviction, a new heart, a renewed spirit given by You. It's in Your beautiful name I pray. Amen. Amen.